Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
Now, we know that, biblically speaking, that the prophets, the apostles, Moses himself, they all speak about a consistency of marriage. And that same consistency is used in regard to our spiritual condition. Meaning, when we violate biblical principles concerning the covenant of marriage, we will be affected. We are going to see things happening in our marital relationships that are adverse. Likewise, when we violate spiritual principles, we see that our covenantal relationship with God also suffers. Now, there's a connection between marriage and spirituality, and this is what I'm referring to. Many times when I sit down with a couple, they share with me in a very fond manner the beginning days of their life together. After that marriage, they'll speak about their honeymoon and that first year and that second year of marriage. And sadly, after 10, 15, 20, 30 years, it seems that much of the joy, much of the contentment, much of the satisfaction is gone. And sadly, many believers have a similar experience. When they talk about their relationship with God, their salvation experience with Messiah Yeshua, they talk about it at the very beginning, that mountaintop experience, how happy they were. But as time goes on, there are problems. That joy, that excitement, that commitment seems to have fallen away. Well, this is exactly what God is speaking to the children of Israel as we continue on in this prophecy of Hosea in chapter 9. So look with me to that 9th chapter, and let's begin in verse 10. Now, God's going to be speaking about Israel from the early stages. And notice what he says. Chapter 9 and verse 10. He says, as grapes in the wilderness, I found Israel. Now, you know something. Grapes are not found in a desert or a wilderness. And if someone was there walking in a desert and suddenly he found a vineyard, he would be very excited. And in that same way, when God was speaking about the patriarchs, he was looking at different people and he found something rare, rare as grapes in a desert. He found a faithful man, and that man was Abraham. He found another faithful man, and that man was Yaakov or Jacob. And we're going to focus in on him in a little bit. So look again at verse 10. He says, as grapes are in the wilderness, I found Israel. As the first fruits of the fig tree at the very beginning. And here again, what he's talking about is this, the season. People are excited at the beginning of the harvest. So someone, he plants a fig tree. According to biblical law, one can't eat the fruit the first 3 years of production. The fourth year, it's all given to God. And then finally, that fifth year, so he's been waiting a considerable amount of time. And now finally is the year that he can enjoy. He's waiting and waiting and waiting, and the first fruits appear at that first part of the harvest. He's excited. And what God is saying here is that he was excited about the faith of the patriarchs, the beginning, the origins of the people of God. But sadly, something has changed. He says here, this is how I have seen your fathers. Behold, and now we move on to the second part of verse 10. He says, they, and it's emphatic, they came to what? But they came to Baal Peor. Now, if you know anything about Baal Peor, you can read about it in the book of Numbers, chapter 25. You can also see something very graphic about that experience of the children of Israel there in Psalm 106. And what we know is this, that Israel fell into idolatry in the most worst way. And so all the foundation of the patriarchs, their faith, they're pursuing the covenantal promises of God. How pleasing that was. It all came to a crushing halt where, in a very unique way, out Baal Peor. Now, here's what I'm trying to tell you. There's people, you and me, that we're walking along in the faith and then something happens. We have that crisis. There is a major sin in our life. We fail God in a big way. That's how God is looking at the children of Israel. For they were, continue on in verse 10, for they separated themselves at Baal Peor, where? For shame. And they became, and what it literally says, is that they became an abomination. What did? That which they loved. So there's two ways that we can actually translate that last part of verse 10. They became an abomination as the very things that they loved. Or we can look at it and simply say that they loved their abominations, and that's how they began to thought. Either way, what it's trying to say is that Israel is no longer pleasing to God, that Israel has fallen away from the favor of God. And perhaps that's how you have felt, that you have failed God, that you have blown it in a big way, and that now God has kind of turned away from you. You're not experiencing His presence. You're not experiencing His anointing, that joy of the Lord, that excitement to worship, that desire to open up and read His Word of God is not simply there in your life. But here's the good news. We're going to see that God can bring about restoration. But there's a process. And this is what that latter half of chapter 9 is going to be dealing with. We'll move on to verse 11. Now, verse 11 begins the process. We need to know some things. We need to know that God is very sensitive. That is this, as we talked about in an earlier lesson. These little things make a great deal. Don't underestimate the spiritual importance of small things. Why do I say that? Verse 11. Ephraim, like a bird that flies away, is their glory. So if God's going to be pleased with us, understand, it's the little things. And just like it's very, very easy to scare away a bird, cause him to fly away, in that same way, the glory of God, that is His presence and the manifestation of His power in your life, is very, very easily moved aside. By what? Faithlessness. By what? A desire to sin. A desire for your will rather than the will of God. And here's the problem. Look at the end of verse 11. Verse 11, he says three words. He says birth, then he says womb, and then he says conception. Now, what's he talking about? He's talking about an intrinsic problem with the people of God. He says, you know, They were this way from birth, and not just from birth, but from the womb, and not just from womb, from the very conception. Now, what is that trying to allude to? A very important principle that we need to understand if indeed there's going to be restoration in our life. Here's what I'm talking about. If I am problematic, if that problem spiritually is not just beginning now that I'm 52 years old or 42 or 32 or whenever in my life, but it goes all the way back to the day I was born. Wait a second. Not just the day I was born, but even in the womb, that problem was there. In fact, I was conceived based upon that problem. The problem is sin. Well, then what chance do I have? Well, what's God trying to allude to here? That if we're going to be different, then we need to be that new creation. And here's what happens. Lots of believers, they don't live in the new creation. They don't live in a way that gives them access to that anointing, to that power. And where do we find access? Through His Word, through obedience to His truth, through prayer, through listening to God, through obeying Him. See, one of the things that releases great power, spiritual power in our life, is when we put truth into action. When we step out in faith and we do what God commands us to do, there's going to be a response from Him. Otherwise, we're going to live under the defeat that is intrinsically us all the way back from the day that we were born, conceived, and in that womb. Verse 12. Now, it's talking about judgment. If there's no change, what is God going to do? Look at verse 12. For He says, for if you raise their sons, He says, I will cause the bereavement of man. Now, what He's talking about is this. See, men, in a natural sense, left to themselves, don't bless, they bring about destruction. I mean, we look in society. We see crime, we see pain, we see suffering, we see an increase in war. See, where man is, there is suffering. And what God is saying, look again at this passage. He says, you know, if you just raise children, if that's all you do is just beget children, you're going to be very grieved over the consequence of humanity. That's what He's talking about here. He says, for also woe will be to them. When I depart from them. So what He's saying is this. If a child does not have the influence of mighty God in their life, if they don't have that spiritual presence guiding them, directing them, if you're not training your children in that manner, what's going to happen? Well, you're going to come to a point when you look at your children and you're going to be bereaved over them. Now, that word bereaved usually is related to death. And what you're going to see is this, all those hopes, all those desires, dreams that you had for their life, they're going to be so far removed. Why? Because they're not living according to the truths of Scripture. Now, I realize that I say that sentence a lot, not living according to the truth of Scripture. But if you were to ask me, what is our work all about? Why do we do these broadcasts? Why do we have these seminars? Why are we living in the nation of Israel? Why have we invested and purchased a study center there where we're training people to take that word among the Jewish people? Very simple. Because we believe more than anything else, people are dependent upon the truth of the Word of God. And it's only when people begin to submit to that truth that change, godly change, is going to become a reality in society. And it begins at each individual's home. So He's speaking here that if these changes aren't brought about, it's going to be woe when what? When God leaves them. Look at verse 13. He says, Ephraim, when I saw Tyre. So what He's speaking here is this. He saw Tyre in Lebanon, and He saw Ephraim. But the difference was that He chose Ephraim for His purposes. So He says, Ephraim, when I looked at Tyre, it was planted in the oasis. He says, so I moved what? I could have chosen Tyre, but I chose you, and I saw you with such great potential. I saw you as those who had that origin through the patriarchs of faith. But what happened? Notice how far the people fell. And Ephraim brought forth his sons to the murder. Now, how do we understand that? Well, remember, in this passage, we're talking about Baal Peor. What's Baal Peor? A place of great shame that the children of Israel fell into idolatry. And based upon Psalm 106, we see that at Baal Peor, the children of Israel, Ephraim, sacrificed their children to that fake and pagan god. So great hardship took place. Great misfortune, great sin was the outcome, and God was grieved over it. So it says, and here the prophet is speaking, he says, give to them, O Lord. What shall I give to them? He says, give to them a womb of bereavement. Now some Bibles translate that as a miscarrying womb, that's fine. And also dry breasts. What's he speaking about here? Well, it's talking about a lack of fruitfulness or a lack of sustaining life. A miscarrying womb, the conditions are not right for life to be born out. Or dry breasts, uses the word somkim, which is derived from the modern Hebrew word for raisin, that is dried up. In the sense that what? There's no milk for what? For the nourishment of that child. So over and over, what we're seeing is this. When God begins to move away, all his provisions do as well. And the end outcome is death, both physical death, but also spiritual death. Look on at verse 15. For their evilness in Gilgal, for there I hated them, according to all the wickedness of their deeds in my house, from my house, I am going to cast them away, and I will not continue to love them, for all their leaders are sorerim. Now, this is an important word. I would say to you that verse 15 is one of the harshest verses in all of Scripture. It speaks about God getting right to the point where he wants to end all of his covenantal relation with the children of Israel. And notice what he says at the end. I did not translate that word, sorerim. This is a very significant word. We find it in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 21. It has to do with a son who is wicked, who will not submit to authority, who will not be accessible to his parents' teaching. He does whatever he wants, and he's causing more and more havoc in the community. To the extent, there's only one last thing that you can do, and what is that? It talks about bringing the child out to the elders of the city. And the city coming together, and the parents confessing they have done everything, and that son will not submit to instruction. He will not respond to authority. He will not be taught. And then one by one, the elders, following the parents, stone that child to death. What this is talking about is ultimately the hopelessness of Israel in their present condition. So I want you to see, chapter 9 begins in with a very, very harsh statement, and it doesn't get any better. Look at verse 16. For strike Ephraim to their very roots, let them dry up. For the fruit they will not produce, and also children, if there are, he says, I will put them to death, who is the desire of their womb. So God is speaking about judgment in very harsh terms. Now, most of the time, we don't hear this type of description of God, but we need to, because this is the God that's going to manifest himself in the last days. Now, most of you know, we have completed a study of the book of Revelation. And one of the purposes of the book of Revelation was to give us new insight, a new perception of Messiah. See, the first time Messiah came, he says in the book of John, I have come apart from judgment. That is, he did not come to condemn this world, but the world might be saved. Here's what the book of Revelation wants us to know about Messiah Yeshua, and that is this. When Jesus returns, he is not coming apart from condemnation, quite the contrary. He is coming to judge. He is coming to measure out his wrath in this world. And that's why it's so important that we have a right perception and understanding of God. And that's what Hosea is telling the people in this time. Verse 17. Says, and he will loathe them. Who's that? My God. Now, my God is the God of Scripture. My God is the God of prophecy. So Hosea is saying here, my God is going to loathe them. It's a very strong word. It is a word of rejection, a word of disgust. For they will not listen to him. And then he says, for they have wandered where? Among the nations. And here again, that term nation has what? Refers to those who have no covenantal relationship with God. What's the key thing that we see in the covenant? Promises. So they have no hope of the promises of God being realized. Well, that's where chapter 9 ends, but there's more. Move now into chapter 10. Initially, things don't change. Why do I say that? Chapter 10, verse 1, speaking about Israel, it says, Israel is an empty vine. What's a vine supposed to produce? Well, we have a prayer. Borei Pri HaGefen is the conclusion of that prayer. It means who creates the fruit of the vine. Biblically speaking, there's a relationship between the vine and fruitfulness. But what it's saying here is that Israel is an empty vine. And it says, if he produces fruit, he produces fruit to himself. And he says, as the abundance of his fruit, what does he do? He multiplies altars. And that is not altars for the living God. That is not a place to worship the God of Israel. Why do we know that? How can we be so dogmatic? Very simple. The word here for altar is not mizbeach, but mizbachot. What's the difference? One's singular and the other is plural. What it's talking about here is the multiplication of altars. Why? Well, we say Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. So there's only one altar for one God. But pagan gods have numerous altars. And that is to tell us that Israel's empty. There's no fruitfulness. And if there is fruit, he uses it for idolatry. Second half of verse 1, he says, as the good of the land, he has what? Literally, he has made better. I would say he has improved what? He has improved the graven images. Verse 2. And what we see here is that their heart is divided. And now he will be found guilty, or they will be guilty. And we see that he will be brought down, that God is going to bring down their altars. And he is going to destroy their graven images. Verse 3. For now they say that we have no king, for we do not what? We do not fear the Lord. Now, here in this scripture, we see Israel falling to a new low spiritually because they don't want a king. And they say, you know, we don't fear the Lord. Why? Why is that the case? They say, for the king, and here they're referring to God, he says, what is he able to do to us? So they have no fear of God. And it's interesting of the change of terminology. Instead of talking about Lord or God, they use the term king. Why? King is rule. What they're saying is, we submit, we acknowledge no rule of God over our life. And this God, if he did exist, what could he do to us? So it's great pride and just being so offensive to God. And that should tell us now why God said the things that he did in the second half of chapter 9. Move on to verse 4. It says, they speak words, but their words are what? Their words are vain oaths. They make a covenant, but this covenant is not a covenant of God. It's not a covenant that is going to produce blessings in their life. That's what a true covenant does. That's God's motivation for entering into a covenant relationship. But what does it say about this covenant that they cut, this faithless people? It says it is going to spring up. What's going to spring up? It says Rosh. And here, Rosh is what? It is a poison. It says poison is going to spring up upon what? In the form of judgment upon all their rows, their many rows of the field. Now, why is that important? Well, here's what we find, biblically speaking. If you look at the first five books in the Bible, you're going to find that God speaks greatly about agriculture. In fact, many, many of the commandments are agriculturally related. And what we find is that there's a connection between the produce of the land and what? And the outcome of the people of God. Meaning this, if the people walk in faithfulness, the land's going to produce its fruit. If the land doesn't produce its fruit, it's because the children of Israel are not obedient to the things of God. So here, when we look at this passage of scripture, it says that there's going to be judgment like poison upon the rose of the land. It's in the plural. It ought not be. What it's saying here is Israel is planting double, and there's going to be a judgment. Instead of giving care to the land. Now we remember, one of the commandments is Shemitah. What's Shemitah? That every 7 years you do not sow the lands, the fields in the land of Israel. Now, here's something that a lot of people don't know. That mitzvah, that commandment, is only for the land of Israel. Outside the land of Israel, you can sow every year. Many people say, well, I'm going to follow that even if I live in whatever country. You ought not. Why is that? Because that commandment is supposed to remind us of the uniqueness of that land. That land has been sanctified. All the world has not been sanctified. The land of Israel has. And another thing that we see here in regard to the Torah is that when you sow the land, you only sow one type of seed in one field. You don't double. That's what he's talking about here. People who are violating the law of God, trying to get a double blessing. See, you'll never be blessed when you violate truth. And there's people that want more and more. They're not satisfied with a good produce of the land. They're trying to get more. It's what we talked about, that spirit that wants to do less, but get more. So God says there's going to be judgment upon these people. Well, read on. Verse 5, talking about the calves of Bet Aven. He says, they're going to fear. What are they going to fear? Well, they're going to fear God's judgment. It's what we talked about earlier in another session. These calves, which are no gods, they have no intelligence. It's poetic language. It's talking about that the idols, they can't speak, they can't hear, they can't move. They're smarter spiritually than the people of Israel. Because they understand this fear, this judgment that's coming. And it says, the dweller of Shimron, it says, for there's going to be great mourning for him by his people. Who's him? This calf. God is going to bring judgment. And what's the outcome of that judgment? The judgment is going to be that idolatry is going to be moved to destruction. God is going to put Israel in a position where they can't even practice idolatry. That's how much they're going to be suffering. And what we need to understand about that is this. When God loves someone, he disciplines them. And when you are in a position that you can't do anything, it's a great position to be in. Why? Because you can cry out to God. And it's that cry that begins that process of renewal. Well, again, we're out of time until next week when we press on into our study.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with him. Shalom from Israel.